So today, Jacob and Temple, we're going to learn about, we're going to do two experiments, and we're going to learn about floating magnets, chemical reactions, and human reactions, and how the three relate to each other. Any questions so far?
Nope.
Okay. What do you have? Question, Temple?
How come it's always about magnets?
Because magnets are the way that atoms were discovered, and you're made of atoms.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Why do those magnets float?
Because they're floating on foam, and foam is buoyant, which means it's lighter than water.
Oh, now I get it. Like a boat?
Like a boat, yeah. They're floating on little boats. Okay, so today we're going to talk about big questions that kids ask. And Temple, you're 8, and Jacob, you're 7, right? So mm-hmm. We're going to talk about the questions that kids your age like to ask. So today, this is our lecture talk. It's going to be floating magnets, which we saw over there, and humans, which are what we are, and power means heat. And we're going to use the magnets to explain how atoms are atomic geometries, and we're made of atoms, so we're like atomic geometries. This is British philosopher, journalist, and TED curator Chris Anderson. Now, his parents were surgeons. They were missionaries in India. You know where India is?
That has India
elephants.
Okay, let's take a look at this map here. Okay, so he grew up over here. Now, in India, they have a different religion than we have in America. It's
so
called...
This whole thing is India where...
Mm-hmm. You see how he has the little jacket there? He's kind of has Asian addressing to him. And their religion is called Hinduism. In some parts of India, it's called Buddhism. And they have a different religion. But then he went to Oxford, and he got a degree. He studied philosophy, which is the ways people think. And then he became a journalist, which he learned how to write. So now we're going to talk about the questions that he had as a kid when he was growing up, that he figured they were going to be answered later on.
On a typical day at school, endless hours are spent learning the answers to questions. But right now, we'll do the opposite. We're going to focus on questions where you can't learn the answers because there are none. I used to puzzle about a lot of things as a boy. For example, what would it feel like to be a dog? Do fish feel pain? Well, how about insects? Was the Big Bang just an accident?
This is the way a lot of adults think about things right now.
So,
that God created
sure
the universe, and he sheathed out what's called the Big Bang,
so many innocent
and then
people
we formed later on, 4.5 billion years
is
ago.
Is there really a plan for my life? Is the future yet to be
this question
written?
You might think about.
Or is it already written? We just can't see it. But then, do I have free will? Who am I anyway? Am I just a biological machine? But then, why am I conscious? What is consciousness? Will robots become conscious one day? I mean, I kind of assume that someday I would be told the answers to all these questions. Someone must know, right?
Mom? But
guess what?
Dad.
No one knows.
Definitely.
Most of those questions puzzle me more now than ever. But diving into them is exciting because it takes you to the edge of knowledge. And you never know what you'll find there.
So here's the Earth. And what's that?
The moon.
Moon, right. How come it's lit up on this side?
Because the sun is shining on that side, and the other side is dark, now shining on the other side.
All right. And what is it shining on the moon?
It's dark.
It's shining light. And remember we talked about light over here? Remember what type of force is light? Remember we said there's three kinds of forces? Which force is this one? It starts with an E. Electromagnetic force. Good, you're getting close. Now what about the force that the moon is attached to the Earth? Now what kind of, there's three forces we talked about. Remember the one about the apple? When we're gonna drop the apple on your head? What force is that?
Gravity,
yeah. So the force that holds the moon to the Earth is gravity. So that's, now we've learned about two forces. The first question here, was the Big Bang just an accident, or is there a God? Now, in America, you go to school and you learn about your basics, reading, writing, and arithmetic. And then you also go to Sunday school 3 weeks, 3 days per month, right? So Sunday school, you learn about Christianity. Now that the Christianity comes from, or you learn about the Bible, right? So you learn about this in Sunday school, right? Did
yes.
You learn about, Adam and Eve and Noah? So then in school, you're going to learn about this theory. Everything's made of atoms, and the universe is 14.7 billion years old. And you'll learn about how everything exploded by what's called a Big Bang. And the universe used to be really small, and it exploded in size and started expanding. And then we formed in the last 200 million years.
Like the dinosaurs?
So the Earth formed, so this happened, this explosion happened 13.8 billion years ago. And then the Earth, so then the Earth formed 4.5 billion years ago.
Oh.
And then
like
after,
the dinosaurs?
Mm-hmm, so then the Sun started heating the Earth, Earth spins on its axis. The Earth rotates, and every day when the Sun comes up, the light from the Sun heats the Earth, and that's what's called a powered chemical reaction. So you see the word here, powered? You think of humans as powered atomic geometries. So power here is the heat that comes from the Sun. So these are the three forces we're gonna learn about today. Gravity, electromagnetic, and nuclear. So.
Excuse me?
Mm-hmm.
What does nuclear mean?
Nuclear, this is when we learned about the atom here. Inside of the atom is the nucleus. So the first
is inside the nucleus.
See those little particles right there?
Mm-hmm.
Those, the red ones are called protons, and they're positively charged. And the white ones are called neutrons.
Excuse me. What is in the neutrons?
Neutrons, inside the neutrons are called quarks.
Quarks?
Mm-hmm.
What are quarks?
They're little particles that make up the neutron. There's six kinds of quarks. They look
what
like
are
this.
Particles?
Particles are things that are real small. So right here are quarks. This is one proton. So nuclear forces right here. So you're made of atoms, and atoms are made of these things called protons, like the.
Those things,
do
they have lines and dots?
You see how it's negatively charged? And this is positively charged? So atoms look like this, and they attract each other. So the positive part is like the nucleus of the atom. It's what's inside the atom. And around it, electrons spin around. Like right here. Okay, so this is what atoms looks like. Now inside is the... So you want to know what nuclear is. So nuclear means what's inside of the atom. So the atom looks like this. It's positive, and these little negative charges are the electrons, and they spin around the atom. And there's 92 kinds of atoms, and they're based on the number of positive charges it has in it. So if it has one charge...
They go around and around and around.
Okay, let's... So for example, do you know what water is? Okay, water...
It's sweat.
Okay, how many kinds of atoms is water made of?
1,000?
There are two types. See this formula here?
It looks like that.
That's what water is made of. So this is hydrogen, and this is the smallest kind of atom. And hydrogen just has one proton in it and one electron. And that's all it's made of.
Is it like fancy-weensy?
Yeah, it's real small.
Like?
And it's made of two hydrogen atoms, and this is oxygen atom. So apples and humans are made of atoms. And inside of atoms are called protons. And inside of protons are called quarks.
And what's inside quarks?
And nobody knows.
Nobody knows?
Mm-mm. But inside of quarks, or inside of the, what holds the quarks together is called the nuclear force.
It's a nuclear force.
And that's a little small, and you can't see it. So the ones that... Yeah, like we can, you know how we felt the gravity? When we dropped the apple on your head, that's gravitational force. And when we did the experiments, that's electromagnetic force. So the inside, the thing that holds the quarks together, just like the electromagnetic force holds the protons to the electrons, the nuclear force is inside of the atoms. But you can't feel it because it's real small, but it's very strong. And one more thing we're going to talk about today is the electromagnetic force is made of two parts.
Hey, I can see two arrows.
Magnetic and electric.
And electric.
Okay. So magnetic force.
It gets. Excuse me.
You see, when you take the magnet and put it to the board like that, that's the magnetic force. And electric force, you ever walked on a carpet and your hands got real staticky and you touched something and it sparked you?
Yeah, I did that too when we went to
the
auto show.
Okay, that's the electric force. So there's two we're going to talk about. This is made up.
Excuse me, mm-hmm. I did not know that.
Some people believe in the existence of a person named God that created the universe, and some people don't. Mostly scientists don't believe in them. And people, if you talk to your friends at school or your parents, they do believe in them. But the matter is, so what we're going to do is talk about how these theories come together. So now this part here, this is how we formed. Okay, so these two are two types of atoms, right? Two types of elements. Which one is this one?
It's nitrogen.
Hydrogen.
Hydrogen.
And this one, Temple, which one is this one?
Hydrogen.
Oxygen.
Oh, I thought it was oxygen.
So oxygen can also look like, when we breathe in oxygen, which looks like this. This is air.
Oxygen.
And this is water.
Water.
So air looks like, air is 20% oxygen. So this is two atoms of oxygen
that's
bonded together.
Pencil.
No, this is a pointing stick for a demonstration stick. So this right here explains where we came from. So 4.5 billion years ago, those are two kinds of elements, and our solar system, which is our sun and our earth, are made of 92 kinds of elements. So they started spinning real fast, and they heated up, and that's how the sun formed. And everything started spinning, and the sun, every time it rotates, it heats the earth, and it makes the atoms grow. So the small ones, like hydrogen, they start attaching together.
So like it grows bigger and bigger?
Yeah, it looks like this. Like once, if you have one hydrogen atom, so like right here we have two atoms. These were atoms, we have a structure of two bonded together. But once the sun starts heating the atoms, they start getting bigger, and they form bigger geometries. So these are geometrical shapes.
Like that's that big?
Mm-hmm. So the more the sun heats the earth, the atoms grow bigger like this, and so sooner or later the atoms start moving, and that's where they turn into humans. So this is what geometry means right over here. This is the end part. It's a branch of mathematics that has to do with shapes. All right. So now we're gonna go. So this diagram here explains how we started from atoms. These are more elements: carbon, nitrogen, boron, aluminum, and silicon. And if you heat these atoms in a system, they turn into animals. Like what's this one here?
A newt.
It's a gecko, or a little gecko lizard. Okay. So now we're gonna go to this diagram. So this one explains how the sun formed, and then it started heating these atoms. And when you heat the atoms, they start growing bigger, and they form molecules. And they form molecules. These are all these are different types of molecules.
And then into the dinosaurs?
Yeah, you see the dinosaur right there?
Yeah.
240 million years ago, dinosaurs formed, but they went extinct.
Whoa.
Do you know what extinct means?
That means they're not there anymore.
Mm-hmm. Okay, extinct means they stopped reacting. And the reason they stopped reacting was because, or the
volcano.
Scientists speculate that an asteroid hit the Earth and it caused dust to accumulate in the sky, and then it blocked out the sunlight. So without the sunlight heating the earth, the dinosaurs weren't powered anymore. Power means heat. It's like sunlight.
Like the sun is kind of hot.
One thing you have to be careful about is when you say that the atoms or the dinosaurs died. The problem is that is the theories when you talk about life and death, that comes from the Bible, and the Bible comes from Egypt, as we're going to explain. So the way we understand chemistry now is atoms aren't alive or dead. They can be reactive or they can be non-reactive. And they can become animated. Animated means you move like this. Like an animated molecule is like this. Non-reactive is if I throw water on this, it won't react. But when we do the experiments, pretty soon we're going to take baking soda, and we're going to put vinegar in it, and that's going to be reactive. So that's the difference. You'll see bubbles and heat and a volume change. And temperature change. Okay, so then... So anyways, these things... what we learned from this diagram is these aren't alive or dead. This little lizard isn't alive or dead. It's just animated, and it's powered... It's powered by heat from the sun, and it's made of atoms, and it's a geometrical shape. So it's like one of these... These are geometrical shapes. Like, remember this one? What shape is this?
It is a triangle.
Triangle, good. So that's... Geometry is the study of shapes in math. So we're going to learn all these shapes. Now this one, if you go to school, probably in, what grade are you in now?
Second.
First, though, so once you get into fifth or sixth grade, you'll learn this. This is the sun heats the plants, and the plants...
So that's the food chain?
Yeah, food chain. This food chain diagram. So sunlight is electromagnetic force. Remember this light? The light right here is electromagnetic.
Can you draw it?
So the electromagnetic force heats the plants.
Can you draw it?
Electromagnetic force? What it looks like.
Yeah, that one. With the sun and the
Jake.
Plant and the
Jake.
And the lion.
There is an explanation there. You can see it.
I'll put the sun right here. This is the sun right here. I'll put it up here. So you know. So the sun is... Humans are... Powered, which means heat, we're powered by the sun, atomic geometries. So when we eat...
Powered by the moon?
No, the moon is... we're powered a little bit by the moon. Like, when the... You know how chickens make eggs?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that eating corn?
Chickens make eggs, they eat corn. But they lay their, humans make eggs too, and they lay their eggs every 28 days, which is the time it takes for the moon to go around the earth. So remember the picture before with the moon going around the earth, like up here? So...
Like this one?
The moon goes around the earth once every 28 days, like, and that's the gravitational force. So Temple, when you get older, you'll start making eggs, but that's... That's triggered by the gravitational force. So the pull, every 28 days, the moon goes around the earth, and the gravitational force will affect your body chemistry and your mind chemistry, and you'll make eggs like chickens. And chickens make eggs every day, though. Or every 3 days. Yeah, they make them every, I don't know what number, they make them about every day. But it's triggered by the gravitational force.
We can make eggs?
No, just females can.
Jake?
All right, now watch. We're going to go to the next one. Oh, so this is the food chain. So probably in sixth grade, you're going to learn about this. So the sun heats the plants. And the plants, they react with the air around them. Remember, air is made of parts of oxygen? And they make something called...
And then the deer eats the plant, and then the lion eats the deer.
But the problem here, you're going to learn about what's called photosynthesis.
Okay.
That's okay, Patox. Okay, so the plants, the sunlight makes what's called sugars. You know when you put sugar in your cereal and it tastes good? So that's where our sugar comes from the plants. And the heat, which is called the light of the sun, is what? Which one of these forces is light? Remember the we pointed over here?
Electromagnetic force.
Good job. You're learning. So electromagnetic force takes the atoms from the air and it makes sugar. And the sugar goes into the plants, and the animals eat the plants, and then we eat the animals. And that's the food chain. But today we're also going to learn how the electromagnetic force triggers reactions between people. Like, say somebody in class says something mean to you, like you lied to me or something like that, or you didn't do your homework, or you didn't clean your dishes. Like when Sarah gets mad at you, that's the electromagnetic force. So remember in this guy here, he says, "Is there a plan?" Well, now we're up to this part.
Is there really a plan for my life?
Okay.
Is the future yet to be written? Or is it already written? We just can't see it. But then, do I have free will?
So pretty soon, right now, you're living with Sarah. But in about 10 years, you're both going to move out. And you're going to have a plan for what you want to do with your time, with your days moving around. Okay.
Is there really a plan for my life?
So you're going to have to think about
the future
plan.
Yet to be written?
They'll start wondering about the future. Not right now,
just
probably.
But then, do I have free will? Who am I anyway? Am I just a biological machine?
Okay, you see the part when you talk about free will? You know what will is? Like when you...
What's inside the lines?
Hmm?
Beg for something?
No, will is... So, will comes from the electromagnetic force. Like, say
what's
you...
What's inside the bones?
So calcium is element number 20. You see right there? This is what bones are made of. See where it says Ca right there? That's what calcium is. So that's one of those, well, that's one of the elements that are in you, is calcium. And that's what bones, so.
Why am I conscious? What is consciousness?
So this is where the electromagnetic force
works
in your brain.
I mean, I kind of assume that
say when you get hungry and you decide to eat,
I would be told the answers.
That's your will
to all these questions.
Making you choose to eat. That's what will is.
Someone must know, right? Guess what? No one knows. Most of those questions puzzle me more now than ever.
Okay, so your will, when you get hungry, then your body starts telling your mind that you're hungry, and then your will is what your, when you, is your, the forces, the electromagnetic forces inside your brain, they make you go to ask Sarah for food. Like we did before lecture, you said you got hungry. That was your will asking Sarah for food. So, this one here, Mary Oliver, she says, the questions, when pretty soon when you turn about, probably next year you'll start thinking about this temple, because you won't think about it right now, but she says, Mary Oliver is a poet, and she asks, well, what is she going to do with her one wild and precious life? So this person, one example of what you can do here, Howard Thurman, he's a inner voice philosopher, which means he listens to his... Instead of listening to, like Sarah tells you to do something, but you don't want to do it, you start listening to your inner voice. So you have a competition between those two things. Like sometimes your inner voice will tell you to do something, you want to do something, or that Jacob will say, let's go play. So that's what inner voice is. But he says, what the world needs is, don't ask yourself what the world needs, ask yourself what makes you come alive, and then go and do that, because what the world needs is people that have come alive. So when you talk about, so this is the word you probably want to focus on here is come alive. Remember how we said that atoms and molecules aren't alive, but they can become more reactive? Like the hydrogen, it's not, we don't really think of it as alive or dead, but we think of it as it can become more reactive, and that's kind of what he means here when he says you can, when you come alive.
Can you read the baby one?
Okay,
the baby
so we're going to do that. The baby, okay, so... The next one is, how do you know when you come alive? Technically, reactions actuate in the sense that they're coming alive are those that are exothermic. That means they give off heat. We're almost getting to the experiment parts. So here's where we are here. Here's a guy and a girl that are dating, or they're friends. And they're having, we can think of them as reactants, which is just like, do you want a reactant to this? So let's say we take hydrogen, we put two of these here. This is what's called a chemical reaction. I'll do it up here. Okay, now we're going to learn about reactants. This is the element hydrogen. Remember, it has one one proton and one electron going around it? These are reactants. These are products. So this is what goes in. This is a chemical reaction. This is one of the simplest ones. And we're going to do a couple in a minute where we can measure the temperature. So reactants are the atoms that go into a reaction, and these are the products of what comes out. So, for example, when your mother and your father met each other, they were reactants, and one of the products that came out was you, as a chemical that came out, like an animated molecule. So, just see right here, people are interacting with each other. This is reactant A and reactant B, and what comes out is a baby, and this is what's called double displacement reaction. Now, in the old days, like when you go to, and see the formula here, this is called free energy, G. It stands for Willard Gibbs, the guy who wrote this. This is what Willard Gibbs looks like. You see this guy right here? Willard, here, Jacob. You see this, his name Willard Gibbs, the G here? He wrote this book in 1878, that was over 100 years ago. And so this G right here is called free energy. That's the energy that formed you. And do you have any questions so far? Now this one here is called temperature. And when we measure, here, okay, put out your hand, Temple. Okay, Jacob, look, we're gonna measure Temple's temperature. So we take this right here. Okay, now you can measure room temperature, or you can measure surface temperature. So now we're gonna measure Temple's surface temperature. And it says she's 92.3 degrees.
What?
So that's temperature. So that's what
Let's T. Let's do mine.
Okay, right, let's write that down. So T, see the temp? 92.3.
Let's do mine.
Okay.
Okay. Let's do
Okay, ready?
Okay. Don't hold my hand, big baby.
About here. Okay, you're 97, look at yours, 97.7. You see, it's different. So he's hotter than you are. So temperature, Temple. Temperature, Jacob.
That's not a J.
Jacob.
97. So this temperature is hotter than this temperature. So you see, anyways, when this goes into the, when you, after you get into high school, you'll start, you might, I'm taking math classes and science classes. And then just, right now you're just learning how to read, but if you later, you're going to learn how to do work with equations. And this is what's called a thermodynamic equation. So this is G, it's called free energy after this guy here, Willard Gibbs. This H is called enthalpy. The T is the temperature we just measured. And S is called entropy. It's called the the transformation content. So this is how babies are formed, and according to science, by the energy of the universe. Creates bigger atomic geometries by this heating of the sun powering atomic structures. So the problem is, or the old-fashioned way when you learn about things is when you go to Sunday school, you'll learn that humans come from Adam and Eve, and that God created Adam and Eve, and that comes from some what did you guys learn so far in Sunday school? Okay, take a look here. So you see right here, if you go into the Bible and you read Genesis chapter 1, Jacob, look here. So when you go to Sunday school, you're going to learn this. If you read Genesis and you go to chapter 2, you'll see where it says Adam and Eve. Those are the first two humans according to the Bible. And it says that God created man in his own image. And then they went under the tree of life. of good and evil. And so this model...
Good and evil?
You know what good is?
Yeah.
What is it?
I'm good. That means you don't do anything wrong. Not a single one.
Okay, what is evil?
Evil is
really
bad.
You
do a lot of stuff.
Okay, that's good. So now you're...
It means bad stuff.
So that's what... But this model of... Now we're going to learn here. You see right here? You see this part right here where the... This is called Egyptian theology. Now the Bible, the part you learn in Sunday school, comes from Egypt. When it was originally written. And it's called the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Like, say, do you know what the pyramids are? Did you learn about them yet? The pyramids in Egypt?
The Egyptian Book of the Dead.
So, if say you end up taking a trip to Egypt one of these days, and you look at the... In Egypt, they
like
would...
Like a dog head.
In Egypt, when they would bury people, and they would bury them inside of the pyramids. Pyramids look like this. This is a pyramid. See right there where it says Nu? And it's a land mound. So when they would bury people in the old days, they would write these inscriptions like this, but they would carve them into the stone, like with chisels. And so the original story, this was 5,000 years ago. This is a god named Khnum and Isis right here, and they're two little figure. These are little clay figurines. And now, when you see the word, it says Adam right here. In Hebrew, Adam means clay. So what the Christian authors did was they rewrote this. You know what clay is?
It's like this thing that you measure, like Play-Doh.
Like silly putty? Yeah, Play-Doh. Clay is kind of like Play-Doh. So in Egyptian religion, what they did was they would, the theory where humans came from was this god named Khnum made clay figurines. You know how you take Play-Doh and you make little humans? Or you make shapes like little animals with Play-Doh? Or clay. So that's what they did. And this goddess Isis here. Isis is, have you learned about Jesus in Sunday school? Well, what was Jesus' mother's name? Mary.
Oh.
The Virgin Mary?
Oh my goodness. Jacob, that's a huge football all about Jesus.
All right, well, anyways, the original Mary was this person named Isis, and her other name was Star of the Sea, and sea is called Maris, so as in, like, when you hear the word maritime, that ships use, that means sea. So the original Mary was this goddess named Isis, and do you know what the cross is?
It's like when God died.
You know the shape people wear on their necklace?
Like this?
With the when you go to church and you see the cross, the people wear it, the preacher wears it.
That's
awesome. Here, let me see when you guys draw the cross. That's pretty good. But it looks more like this. It's longer. So when you go to the original cross, it looks like this. See the thing that she's holding in her hand right there? It's called the ankh.
The heart.
The ankh is the breath of life. So the original cross used to look like this. So this is Christianity, and this is Egypt. You've seen this symbol, right, when you go to Sunday school? Okay, so before, Christianity used to be called the Egyptian religion, and the cross looked like this. So, an original model of where humans came from, Isis is taking the cross, and she's putting the breath of life into the clay figurines. So when that got rewritten into the Bible, the little breath of life became the spirit of God. So, did you learn about spirit or soul?
Soul.
What's soul?
Maybe. The gut.
Did you learn about soul temple or spirit? When you're, according to the Bible, when you're born, you get a soul and a spirit. Now, a soul, according to the Christianity, is how good you are. Like, you know how you said you understand what good and evil are, right? So the more good you are as a person, the better your soul is. Now, spirit is how, if you have a good spirit, it's kind of like how reactive you are. It's like how much energy you have. So in the Egyptian version here, she's putting the spirit into the clay figurines and they come alive. And that got rewritten into the story of Adam and Eve. You see where it says Adam there? And that means clay in Hebrew or Egyptian. So right now, you see this right here? See this movie that's coming out right now, Noah? Let's see.
So this is a race?
Noah, you learned about Noah when he took on the animals on the ark when the world flooded. Did you learn about that?
No.
Yeah, we learned about
it's
it. On Jacob's. You see how he had an apple?
No. What did he say?
He's going to destroy the world. It begins. Sarah, you haven't seen that yet, have you?
I have not.
Can we see that one with the raccoon
one? Okay, so when you read the one, probably next year when you go to Sunday school, don't touch it. When you go to Sunday school, you learn about how that there was a big flood. You'll learn about how Noah took two of every animals and his family and built an ark, which is a big boat, and then everybody else flooded and died, according to the Bible. And then there was a big flood.
So this is real?
No, this is how the Egyptians understood the universe. So these are in Egypt. Like, all these are different pyramids. Okay, see how everything's flooding?
Yes.
Now where that comes from is this. The Nile River. Okay, so you see the Nile River right here? So they built these pyramids around the Nile River, right about all along the Nile River. Hey, you remember how you said, is this a true story?
No, I said that.
Okay, so where the story comes from is 5,000 years ago, the Nile River would flood, and it floods.
That's almost from the dinosaurs.
Okay, take a look. Right up here, this is part of Egypt where the Nile River is. And up the top there's the Ethiopian mountains. And every year the snow in the Ethiopian mountains melts and the Nile River floods, and it floods for 120 days. So that's where the story where the flood came from. The Nile River would flood, and then when it receded, it left all this black soil on the ground, which was real fertile, and it could grow a lot of crops. And so they thought the idea that life could come from the soil after the flood receded. So that's where this story comes from, is the Nile River flood. Now when the...
Can you see that one that says animals?
Jacob.
No, wait. So see right here? See where the water is right here? The idea was that when the flood went down, the land, a pyramid would arise, just like the... You see how the bank of the Nile is real fertile and has lots of life? So when the flood recedes, there would be black soot left over and life would go out from the plants. And so the theory that the Egyptians conceived was that the land rose out, the whole earth was flooded. Like, see how there's water right here? You see the water on the globe? In Egyptian times, they used to think the earth was flat and everything was covered with water and that a land rose out of the earth. And so that's where this comes from. But keep things moving. So see this guy Noah right here? In Egyptian, his name was Nu or Nun. And in the Egyptian story, the Nile River flooded for 120 days. And then at the end of it, everything was dark and a bird called the phoenix, a fiery bird, burst forth and carried the sun on its head. And that's how the Egyptians believed that the universe was created. So as we learn more, this model became less. So Jacob, where did this guy's name come from, Noah?
Noah. From the Egyptians.
Yeah, but what was its original name? Nu. Or Nun. So Nu became Na, which was Noah. Or in a movie, you'll see Russell Crowe playing it. So in the Christian version, instead of releasing one dove, one bird comes up at the end of the flood. In the Christian, you'll read that there was, he releases three birds every 40 days. And then on the 120th day, the sun shines. And then he lands, his ark lands on a mountain, which is this mountain here. And now we're going to go to experiments. Okay, so now we're going to talk about hot and cold reactions. And we're going to watch the Katy Perry video to understand what we're talking about here.
Bird watching Viva?
Katy.
So try to understand what she means by hot and cold when you read this.
Be you laugh with the weather, cousin.
Thank you.
Alexander.
Just watch a little bit of it.
Take Katy to be you laugh with the weather, one.
I should know.
You guys heard this song before?
No.
Okay, so what do you think she means by cold when she says that, when she's singing this?
She's angry at him that she didn't say.
Yeah, that's pretty good. So that's loosely what cold means. So Jacob, what do you think she means by hot when she's singing?
I don't know.
Tempo, what do you think?
That she's really
angry then cold? No, hot means they're happy together. I mean, their relationship's going good. Cold, the way she's usually saying it is like, say when you're, how many friends do you have at school, Temple?
I have one friend.
25 it's friends?
No, I don't know.
You ever had a friend that stopped talking to you?
Mm-hmm.
Well, sometimes you'll meet friends and they'll stop talking to you. That means, that's an example of cold. They shut down on you and they stop talking. And sometimes you'll meet a new friend where you'll talk a lot and you'll get along with him really good. So that's an example of hot. You get it? Okay. See where she says energy? When she talks about energy, she's talking about this one here. Remember the G from the formula? That's the energy she's talking about. That's the loose idea we're talking about, hot and cold. But now we're gonna do experiments so we can understand it with the. So first we're gonna do a cold.
That means happy together.
Yeah, pretty much. So now we're gonna do a reaction, a cold reaction. So this is what we're gonna do.
It's hot.
Sarah, can you zoom in on that?
Mm-hmm. I'm in there.
Okay. So now we're gonna do a cold reaction. So when you think about this, is vinegar, right here, CH, carbon, oxygen, hydrogen. And remember, all of these are different elements off the periodic table, let me see. The ones we're made of hydrogen, which is this one, right? We're made of oxygen, we're made of nitrogen, carbon, and iron. See where it says Fe right there? And it's a little, looks like a little orange rock or something?
Yeah.
That's one of the elements that's in your blood. So we're made of 26 of these elements. And these are all, the ones over here are all metals. The ones over here are non-metals. They're like in between. And over here we have, these are gases. You see when people ride around their cars with their things, while their cars are lit up? That would be like neon or helium. And they make colors and you put electricity through it. We're going to do a cold reaction. So you can think of these as like people. The vinegar is like, could be like someone, baking soda. Like you could be, Jacob, you could be the vinegar. Temple could be the baking soda. And we mix you together, you get these new, these are called, remember what's, I know, do you guys know the difference between the left and right?
That's left.
This is our left.
And
that's. Okay. So left side, the left side of the reaction are called what? Remember this word here? Reactants. And then the right side are called products. That's what comes out of the reaction. And this is what goes in. Remember, what are these two, when we mix them together, what are they called? Because they're going to go into the reaction. Remember this word? Reactants.
Reactants.
Yeah, they're going to go into the reaction. So, what we're going to do is we're going to put some vinegar in here. Vinegar is this one, remember? Okay. See where it says CH3COOH? Vinegar is technically, it's a type of acid.
Can you put one in the water and this?
Alright, well, let's pour it in. Jake, do you want to pour the liquid in?
Yeah.
Okay, don't put it in the mixer yet. Okay, just pour it like up to here.
Temple, hold the glass for Jacob.
It's not the glass.
Okay, a little bit more. A little bit more. Okay, stop there.
Stop.
Alright.
Next one.
Okay, now we're going to check the temperature. See where it says surface? We're going to measure the temperature at the surface. Okay, so it's 72.9. Okay, let's write that down. See where it says 72.9?
72.9, Temple, that's it.
72.9.
That's it.
Okay, now you gotta write. Not good.
Point.
That's gonna be T1. So we write T.
Temple.
Or T. I stands for initial. That's the temperature, the start of the reaction. Now we're gonna write down temperature final, which is gonna be. After the thing reacts for a certain number, like about a minute, it's going to react. I'll put it in the oven.
Temperature.
Okay, now remember when it reacts, it's going to, this is going to be a cold reaction. Remember what cold reactions are?
Mm-hmm.
Where are they?
Cold.
Remember from the Katy Perry video? What is cold?
Cold means like, you're angry?
A little bit, yeah. Remember how she talked about energy? She was talking about how it's absorbing her energy.
Uh-huh.
So when it grows cold, we're going to observe the reaction. It's going to absorb energy from the room. Like, think of these as little people in here. And they get angry with each other. But when we mix this one with this one, they're going to get angry with each other and they're going to absorb energy from the room. And if the reaction system is going to grow colder. And remember, the energy is the G from Willard Gibbs. So we're going to observe the temperature decrease. So it's going to go from water, these are the reactants, and then after a minute we're going to form the products of water plus carbon dioxide plus sodium ion solution and acetate. And then we're going to check the temperature.
Like this?
Yeah, it looks like this. So we're going to do the thermometer. Okay, I'll just take a little bit.
This much?
No, a little bit less.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so put it in there. I'm going to stop. Okay, so now take your hand off.
What?
Oh my god.
That's a chemical reaction.
Awesome. I
want to
do more.
Okay, so now we're going to, it's going for about 30 seconds there.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Okay, so now we're going to, it's going for about a minute, we're going to check the temperature now. Ready, Temple?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, ready? See what it says now? What number?
64.4.
Okay, write that down.
64.4.
Okay, good. So now, subtract, this is the final temperature, and this is the initial temperature. So we have, this is, do you guys learn addition and subtraction yet?
Addition?
Or subtraction?
Uh-huh.
Okay, so we're going to take T final minus the T initial. This is called delta, it's another Greek word from the Greek, it means change. So we're going to, delta is the difference between the final temperature minus the initial temperature. And we get, hold on, let me add it up, freeze. Okay, so we get negative 8.5 degrees Fahrenheit. So the negative sign here means that the temperature decreased. So originally it was hot. And this is called an endothermic reaction. Endo means heat goes inside. It goes inside, and this means heat. Okay, so you can feel it. You can feel the thing. It grew a little bit colder. Mm. See how it's cold? Mm. Remember when Katy Perry was talking about cold?
Yeah.
When they're arguing, everything got cold. So now we measured temperature change for this reaction, and you can think of these just like people. When you go to interact with people and at your school, like your teachers and your friends, you can think of different people as like baking soda or vinegar. And some people mix together, they get colder. Some people mix together and they get hotter. Sometimes you'll meet people and your relationship will turn into ice. It'll be frigid. So now we're going to do a hot reaction. All right, so that was... Okay, we're going to put this one over here.
Cold. But now we have to use the warm vinegar.
Alright, so now we're going to do this reaction.
Tebo can do the vinegar.
This is going to be a hot reaction. See where it says we're going to demonstrate a hot reaction?
I'm not doing it.
So that means exothermic means heat's going to be released. The reaction system's going to grow warmer. It's going to release energy. And those are good relationships. Remember, hot is good?
Mm-hmm.
So the one we're going to do now is we're going to mix baking soda solution.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, take a little baking soda and put it in there. We're going to make a solution.
This is just
water and baking soda. We're going to mix it until it dissolves.
Like this?
Yeah, put it right in there. Okay, maybe put a little bit more in.
This?
No, a little bit less.
Like this?
Yeah, put that in there. Okay, now mix it with a spoon. And keep mixing it for about a minute until you don't see any more powder. We're making baking soda solution. So the baking soda is going to dissolve. Okay, now it's at 65.7.
65.7.
That means the initial temperature of a reaction is 65.7. So now we're going to do a different reaction. We're going to mix in calcium chloride, which is CaCl2. What you want to do is shake a little bit of this in there.
You can sit on the
There you go, that's good.
Oh.
Now this is an exothermic reaction. The other one absorbed heat and it got colder. This one's releasing heat and it's getting warmer.
Oh my god.
Okay, now we're at the surface. Hold it up next to it. Okay, now write that number down. That's final temperature.
Five.
Okay, remember at T final. Here the temperature changes. You subtract the final temperature from the initial temperature, which means 76.5 minus 65.7. So then you get, so it's plus 10.8 degrees. And this one dropped negative 0.5 degrees. And this was endothermic, which means it's absorbed energy. And this one is exothermic. Which means energy goes out. And this is heat. Okay, so we saw two different kinds of reactions. One was endothermic, the first one. The second was exothermic. The way you understand how this works, you see that little double sign right there? The little triple arrow? This is Charlotte and Edward, and they're married. And the bond is their marriage bond. And so just like people want to marry, they have bonds together, the bonds can store energy.
A, B?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, A, B. There they, Charlotte's the A, Catherine's the B. And so in their marriage, they can store energy. Now, it's to break bonds, normally when you have a happy marriage, the reactions go. Do you know what a golden one anniversary is? Golden means you're married for 50 years. So normally they're hot reactions and they go for 50 years, but sometimes they get cold. So the second reactions, the reactions release, energy is released from the bonds. So exothermic right here, so you have AB. Okay, so Temple, let's say you're A, and you meet a new girlfriend at school, and you guys start hanging out together, like playing on the playground, and you form a bond, a friendship bond. So inside, in your bond, you have the force that holds you together is called the electromagnetic force. It's this force. And so normal reactions, if you're friends, if you're warm with your friends and having a lot of fun, that would be an exothermic reaction. You'll usually release heat. But sometimes, say you're over here, this would be a course of like a month, like a school year. Now, let's say the next school year comes, this is year one.
Sarah.
Now, let's say you and your friend Temple get in an argument, right? Okay, so Temple, let's say next year you get in an argument with your friend and you don't want to play with her on the playground anymore. To break the bond that you have, things start getting cold between you. You stop talking to her. And to break this bond, you have to absorb energy from the outside, which means that your playground and the parts of the town that you hang out and interact with her, they'll get colder. Just like in the reaction cup, we measured things got colder. In the first reaction, this was the first one, things got colder. It started out hot and ended up cold. So energy from your surroundings absorbed energy to break this bond. This is year two. Okay, so you get it, Temple? Endothermic means energy goes in to break the bond. That would be endothermic.
What about the third year?
And this is exothermic. That means that the reaction releases energy. And it forms the bond. During the process of the bond forming, this is exothermic. Alright, so let's go to the next part. We watched this before, we're going to watch it again, so see what we've learned so far.
In the last 10 years, there's been some very interesting developments in evolutionary biology, neurocognitive science, child development research, and many other fields, which is beginning to challenge some of these long-held shibboleths that we've had about human nature and the meaning of the human journey. But there is another frame of reference emerging in the sciences, which is quite interesting. It really challenges these assumptions. And with that, the institutions that we have created based on those assumptions, our educational institutions, our business practices, our governing institutions, etc. Let me take you back to the early 1990s, sleepy little laboratory in Parma, Italy, and scientists had a MRI brain scanning machine on a macaque monkey as the macaque monkey was trying to open up a nut. They wanted to see how the neurons would light up. So the monkey's trying to open up the nut, the neurons light up. And just by serendipity, and this is how science sometimes happens, a human being walked into the laboratory, I don't know if it was by mistake, and he was hungry, he saw the nuts and opened up one of the nuts and tried to crack it open. The macaque monkey was totally shocked because who was this invader in his laboratory?
Okay. See, the monkey is looking at this guy eating his nuts, and he wants to eat the nuts, so he gets so angry, right? But with the one he sees him eating the nuts, what force is that?
Cold.
Oh, no. One of these are the three forces. It's either gravity, electromagnetic, or nuclear.
Nuclear.
No. Okay, what force?
Gravity.
Okay, gravity, yeah. Gravity, so the force,
that's hard.
What's the force that's holding the nuts to the table?
Gravity?
Gravity, yeah. So that's like the, and what's the force that's holding, what's the force when he sees this guy stealing his nuts and he gets angry, what force is that?
Gravity?
No, this one, electromagnetic force. That's the force of light. Okay, Tapa, ready for the apple on top of your head? Oh.
No, Jacob.
Okay, ready? We're going to do this
apple.
Again. Jacob.
No.
Sarah, you want the apple on your head?
Sure. Who's going to record it then?
Me.
Tapa, just let him drop the apple on your head. It's not going to hurt at all.
No. I'll just drop it fast.
It'll drop fast.
This is going to be explained gravity to you.
No.
All right. Jacob, you just sit over there with Tapa.
Come on, Jacob. Be a man.
Come on, sit
Take
there.
The apple.
You get the apple. You get to eat it once it drops on your head. Remember?
But I want the green one to land on my head.
Okay, well, he'll drop the green one on your head.
You
no problem.
Yeah.
Have a seat.
We got a no.
We'll stand over there.
Green. I can't believe I'm doing this.
All right, so this is Isaac Newton. When he was a young boy, he was eating underneath the apple tree, and an apple fell on his head by accident, and he discovered the force of gravity. Okay, ready?
Okay.
Okay.
Yummy.
All right. That didn't hurt so much, right?
Nope.
Did that hurt?
Nope.
Okay, but it was a little bit painful, right? Like a little bit? Like
a tiny bit.
Okay, tiny bit. So sometimes... Now what about when you go down a slide?
On
the playground. You know what a slide is?
Yeah. You go wee.
Okay, that's the force of gravity too. And that's a funner, right?
Yeah.
And so sometimes the gravitational force isn't fun, and sometimes it is fun. And it's the same way with the electromagnetic force. Sometimes it's fun, and sometimes it's not fun. Like the monkey isn't happy right here. So its electromagnetic force, remember, looks like this. Let's look. This is what the electromagnetic force looks like. You see where the apple is dropping on Newton's head, just like it happened to you?
Mm-hmm.
There's Isaac Newton, and that apple dropped on his head, and he figured out the force of gravity. Now, the force of gravity, you can put in terms of an equation like this. You see the mass one right there? That's the mass of the Earth. The mass two is the mass of the apple, and the G is the gravitational constant, and the little r there is the distance between the apple and the Earth. So, when the apple falls on your head, it's this force of gravity that's pulling the apple down. And we could put it in terms of equation. For the electromagnetic force, this is what the electromagnetic force looks like. So you've been talking about three forces. Gravity is the one that drops the apple on your head. Now the electromagnetic force looks like this. And remember how we said it's made of two parts? Magnetic and electric? Temple? You see over here? The light that comes from the ceiling is made out of electromagnetic force. And you see that little E there, the little arrows going up and down? The electromagnetic force goes through the air in two parts. One's called the electric field and one's called the magnetic field, and they're perpendicular to each other. Like one goes like this and one goes like that, and they go through the air. Temple, you see it?
Mm-hmm.
You see the force right there? That's the same force when the monkey got angry.
Mm-hmm.
He got angry because electromagnetic force triggered him into seeing the man eating his nuts. And this is the nuclear force inside of atoms, and this is gravitational force.
And that the first drive is the drive to actually belong. It's an empathic drive. What is empathy? It's very complicated. When little babies are in a nursery and one baby cries, the other babies will cry in response. They just don't know why. That's empathic distress. It's built into their biology. Around 2.5 years of age, a child actually can begin to recognize himself in a mirror. That's when you begin to mature empathy as a cultural phenomenon. And that is once a toddler can identify themselves, then they know that if they're observing someone else have a feeling, they know that if they feel something, it's because they're feeling it because someone else has it. They're two separate things. Selfhood goes together with empathic development. increasing selfhood, increasing empathic development. Around 8 years of age, a child learns about birth and death. They learn where they came from, that they have a one and only life, that life is fragile and vulnerable, and one day they're going to die. That's the beginning of an existential trip.
Guys, talking about free will. Now, in the old days, the Egyptian model, from the Egyptian Book of the Dead, every time you made a choice, it was your will making a choice. And the measure of the choice was your, what's called your soul, or your ba. And that was when you, the Egyptians believed that when you died, you'd go to heaven, and they'd weigh your soul on a scale. And if your soul was too heavy, if you were too evil of a person, then this monster called the mut, which is half crocodile, half lion, half hippopotamus, would eat you, and you'd go down to the lake of fire. And that's where the Christian version of hell comes from.
It's half alligator. Half dog.
No, half hippopotamus and half crocodile. So
half
when
hippopotamus and...
Yeah, you see the bottom
what
part?
What does the body look like?
That's it right there. It's called
human?
Mutt. So when this got... This is called Rene Descartes. This was in 1500 BC and it's carved on the pyramids. But in 1610, Rene Descartes reformulated all this, so he believed that the soul
is... That's really immutable, right?
400 years ago. He's a French philosopher, and he reasoned that humans are pretty much biological machines, like robots, but they have their morality is found in this thing called the pineal gland, which is inside your brain. And that accounts for whether you're a good person or a bad person, where you go, where your mind goes, when your reaction ends into the universe. Now let's move. So this other guy, Anderson, he thought that probably his mother, his father, his teacher, his policeman would answer the question. But normally, you don't learn these answers to these questions until you get to high school or college. But we're learning them a little early today. So then this reaction was, this guy did these same reactions like we're doing right now, but he wrote a whole book about it. So when you get older, you can maybe in a few years be able to read this book and understand how you can understand people as chemicals reacting together. And his name was Johann Goethe.
So we're done?
Yeah, now we're going to do the magnets. So the original guy who did the floating magnets was this guy named William Gilbert, and he did it in 1590. Okay, you see this guy, William Gilbert? He took boats. He was one of the fathers of magnetism. He put these little wooden boats and he put loadstones, which are little magnetically charged stones that would point towards would always point north when people were sailing. And he did the experiment with little boats and floating loadstones in these little dishes. So today we're going to do the experiment using neodymium magnets like we did. So the second guy who did the experiment was this guy named Alfred Mayer. He was an American physicist. And he found all these patterns when he did the experiment. He used up to 20 magnets. So we're going to put the little negative magnets in the water, which are like the electrons. These are the electrons. And we're going to take the positive magnet, it's like the nucleus. And that's going to show how atoms form. And then you'll understand. So from these experiments, these numbers, this guy, J.J. Thompson, took these models and he figured out the atoms look like this. They have this positive charge in the middle and they're surrounded by negative electrons. And so humans are made of atoms. And this is an example of human. You can think of a human as like a molecule. Like that's you right there, and you're made of 26 kinds of atoms. Now this is another molecule, it's a bending molecule. It's like a little, kind of a human, but that bends, that has it's like a little baby. Like when the baby bends its leg. So when light, which is the electromagnetic force, shines onto these bonds right here, the 11 and 12 carbon bond, the molecule reacts and moves and straightens. So this is a primitive type of molecular movement. Now when you get to bigger molecules, some molecules will start walking. Like this is one that's inside your body, it's called myosin. And it walks along actin fibers and carries cargo. Kind of like a worker at a factory carrying things. So this is a molecule that walks and it carries things. So this is almost like a little primitive type of intelligence. And so here's human, is a bigger version of the molecule. So now we're going to do the magnetic experiment. So when you hold the positive charge, see the magnet right there that I'm holding? Take a look at here. So this is a 2-inch by 1/4-inch neodymium magnet. And it's 10 times stronger. You can hold it if you want. But these are, see these magnets here? These are regular magnets. And a magnet means that the electrons are all aligned in a certain position. And when you have an electron lying in a certain position, they all point in a certain direction, and they make a magnetic field go around it. So there's, if I hold this positive end up right here, see these little lines coming out here? These are magnetic field lines, and they come out of the magnet, out of the top, and they go into the bottom. And we're going to use these field lines to make the magnet float in the water, to make these different geometrical patterns. And so, these are the three forces we learned about. Electromagnetic inside are called photons, the particles that make up the force. And the force that makes up the strong nuclear force are called gluons. We learned about those. All right, so now we're going to make some patterns.
If you
want to take 5 magnets, what shape are we going to make?
We are
going
to
make a shape that has 5, and that would be a... What's the name of it?
Pentagon.
Okay, so there's a pentagon. It's almost there. We're going to go to 6.
Number 6. And
what's the name of that one?
Hexagon.
6? Hexagon. Okay, how many... That means it has 6 sides.
Six sizes.
This is almost one. This is still
it looks like a flower.
This one is a pentagon with one in the middle. See how the outside has 5 sides?
Where is that? Number 6 is a pentagon.
So now we're gonna go up to
number 8.
7.
So now we got 7 of them in here.
But
look on a friend with Robert Mayer. Take a look at the shape that we should expect. Or Alfred Mayer. When Alfred Mayer did these experiments and expected, when he put 7 magnets in, he expected this shape. So it's.
So could I put this together?
Why don't you go to the middle?
Temple, move to the left, please.
Number 7?
So if you use 7 floating magnets,
yeah.
What's the outside shape? How many sides does it have?
It has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so there's 6 dots on the outside, so it's making a hexagon.
How many dots on the page? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
So this one is... Outside is a hexagon, and it has a six-sided shape.
Number 8.
And now we're going to do 8. Now if you look at Julius Meyer, when he did 8, he got 3 different possible shapes. Jacob, you see this? When you do 8, you should get 3 different shapes. You can either get 2 will go to the middle, and you'll get 3 different possible shapes.
Does it?
See the different possible shapes you can get?
7. No, it doesn't. It has
how
many dots?
1, 2, wait for it to form.
1, 7, 8.
So what's the outside shape?
9 dots.
So it looks like it's got a hexagon. See right here is the hexagon? This other one doesn't want to come in. So sometimes you can think of these as human relationships. So say you have 7 friends, and this will be like an outcast. You'll tell your friend he can't come into the group. And all this has to do with electromagnetic stability.
This one.
Like say this was your friend, you didn't want to hang out with you. you could, the reason you can't come in because the group's not stable anymore. You get it? See how there's five right here? Six right here, and there's seven right there, but this one can't come in? That's why you get different stability patterns.
Look, it's splitting.
All right, so now we're going to, let's jump up to 10. You should get a little triangle in there.
No, we didn't do number 9.
Okay, well, just okay. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 9.
It's a nondagon.
Jacob, enough.
All right, now I should get a triangle to come in the middle.
So,
how many sides
is this
at? So the outside is what kind of shape? It has seven sides. What's that called? It's a heptagon.
Nondagon.
Now the this one on the outside is a heptagon, and the one on the inside is a triangle.
Nondagon.
No. See number 7. So there's 7-sided shape, and the outside is called a heptagon. And the inside is a triangle.
So it's a nondagon. And look, it's splitting to islands.
So now we'll go up to 12. Alright, so now we got 12. So let's, now we got 12 of these. What pattern are you looking for?
Okay. Is it number 8 or number 9?
There's 12 altogether.
Okay. 12. Dodecadon.
Okay, so you see how there's the square in the middle?
Yeah.
And then there's a square in the middle,
it's
and then there's
a monogon. I mean a dodecagon.
And then there's 8 on the outside. So it's octagon on the outside and a square in the middle.
So it's this.
The outside is 8.
Number 8.
Octagon. You see
it's
right
an
here?
Octagon.
This is the octagon and this is square.
Hey, the friends are in.
So it's a double ringed structure.
Can I do it?
But now we can do.
Can I do
if
it?
If you put. No. Wait, hold on, let me show you. Now we're going to do something different. So there's 12.
It's going to the islands again, Mr. Thims.
Take a look at this one. You see, if I have 6, it's going to form a hexagon with a dot in the middle. So now we're going to use these to show a chemical bond. So if I take 2 of these, I can form 2 different groups. And these are like 2 hydrogen. I don't blow on.
Jacob, do not blow on them.
Okay.
Okay, so what shapes are these? It's a hexagon with a dot with one in the middle. And this is like the... These are what the nitrogen atoms look like. They have... Oh, you see how one? This one stole one from it? This is how atoms bond to form molecules. So this is like, this one here is like...
It's almost like a puppet.
7. So an atom with 7 electrons around it is called nitrogen. And an atom with 5 electrons around it is called... Okay, so now we're going to make... So look on your back sheet here. You see how the things make shapes? This is what atoms. This is what atoms look like. You see the. Okay, you see the positive part here.
It's almost like that.
This is a nucleus, and it's surrounded by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, look here, Jacob. When you have a.
Jacob.
When you have an atom that has a positive charge in the center, surrounded by 7 electrons. The type of atom it's called is nitrogen. So you go to the periodic table, see where it says 7 there? And that's nitrogen. Temple, you see this? So you got 7 electrons with a positive charge. And you see where it says 7 right there? That means nitrogen has 7 electrons around it. And that's the 10, these are the numbers you can see are the kind of atoms that we're forming. So if you take 2 here like this, we're going to make 2 different atoms. Okay, so how many electrons does each one have? How many are there? 6 here, right?
Yeah.
So look.
6 in each.
You see
one.
6 electrons, right?
In each one.
Yeah. Okay, now look on the sheet there and tell me which number is 6 on the yellow sheet.
My chart.
What's, tell me what...
Not your chart, Jake.
No, up to the top. On the other side.
Jake, could put it down.
See where
now.
It says 6? What letter is that?
Okay.
Which one is 6? Oxygen is 8. What's the number above carbon? Well, 6 is above carbon, so these are like two carbon atoms. Now, if you put them together, we can make a bond. Now, these, if I move them together each other, these electrons are going to start attracting to this one, and those electrons are going to start attracting to this one, and they'll form a bond. See how there's new patterns forming?
Yeah.
And these two positive charges push against each other. Like I can.
They're almost like friends.
So this is what's called a molecule. Two atoms bonded together. You get it? So all these electrons, some of them attract to this one, and some of them attract to this one, but these two positive charges are called neutrons. They repel from each other. But the whole thing as a structure holds together.
Like,
so this is kind of what humans are. You get it? Humans are a structure of electrons and protons, and you're stuck together, but you're bigger, but a large number of these. But you can pull them apart, and you can get the. But remember
can
how we talked.
Can you make them dance?
Remember how we did the cold reactions? The cold reactions, you have to put energy in to make the bond come apart.
This is the hot one.
Mm-hmm. So some reactions are hot, they just go on their own, but if things are stuck together, if you do a cold reaction, then they'll pull apart. And that's called, some reactions are endothermic, they get cold, and some are exothermic, they get hot. So it depends on which one. Like this one here is real strong, it holds, this one only holds 5, and this one holds... 7.
What?
There's 6 on the outside and 7, 1 in the middle. So you get 7. So this is a stronger bond right here, but this one is a little disorganized. This is a bigger element. Okay, let's do up to 16. See where it says 16? You should get 2 rings to form. So 12, 13, 14, 15,
and 16.
Okay, so look at the shaker.
I don't know where 16 is.
This one is 16. Look at this, we should get this shape.
It looks like a
10. See where 16 is right here? We should try to find one ring plus another ring plus a dot in the middle. Let's see
like a target. Like a target sign.
Yeah, that good.
So now we're going to be able to get 3 rings. Okay, it's almost there.
It's almost like a school of fish.
Okay, you see the 3 rings?
Mm-hmm.
One outside ring is right there. Then there's a second ring, then there's one in the middle.
This one's in the middle.
So that's 16. So Julius Meyer did
like
this 100 years ago, and he got these same patterns. So we observe the same patterns now, because the properties, this is called the... This is the magnetic force, the one we're doing here, because these are just magnets attracting to each other. And the gravitational force is what holds the magnets to the water. And the parts that hold the... Remember what water is made of? Oxygen and hydrogen?
Mm-hmm.
The forces that hold the hydrogen and oxygen together are electromagnetic force. So now we see 3 different forces here. So this one's magnetic. The ones that hold the tub to the ground is gravitational, and the ones that hold the atoms in the water together is electromagnetic. So now let's do 20.
Jacob, could you sit your head further back?
Why?
Because your head is in the way.
So now we're at Laura.
Is that experiment almost done?
Yeah, now we're doing 20.
20 minutes?
No, 20 magnets.
And then we're done?
Mm-hmm. So remember what rings we should get this. We should get this pattern. See where it says 20 right there? We should get 3 rings to form, plus a 2 in the middle.
I forgot one more.
And this one.
And those.
It's hard to organize 20 magnets, guys.
It's like a full...
Okay,
like
you see how 2 are in the middle now?
It's like sheep.
Just put it closer.
And also, if we want to make
it
stronger,
can put it closer.
We can do this. If you stack two of these on top of each other like this, I guess it makes something more powerful. So now it's more stronger in the middle. Let's see if this works.
Come on, little baby. Maybe you have to put it more close.
It does work. Put it closer.
Awesome.
See how there's two in the middle, a ring, and then another ring, just like in the picture?
Oh, this one's in the middle.
Yeah, those two in the middle. There you go.
Awesome.
Now, you guys want to play with them? Now, the problem when you play with it, don't move it too close to the water.
Because they'll splash
around.
Stick.
Yeah, so you play with one, you can play with one.
Yeah.
Don't
what
go,
do you think?
Go too far. Oh, you see one too far.
No. Keep it higher up. Higher.
They're like fishies. They're like fishies.